Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Our Beloved Kin, A New History of King Philip's War, by Lisa Brooks, narrated by Rainy Fields. The first step in liquidating a people is to erase its memory, destroy its books, its culture, its history. Then have somebody write new books, manufacture a new culture, invent a new history. Before long, the nation will begin to forget what it is and what it was. The world around it will forget even faster. Milan Kundera, The Book of Laughter and Forgetting. Pilikisos, The New Moon.
Pildowi Onsmong Wongon,
A New History. Joseph Laurent, New Familiar Abenaki and English Dialogues. Introduction. The Absence of Presence. As the first leaves of sassafras and strawberry emerged in the Wampanoag country during the spring of 1623, a leader stepped forth to confront Plymouth colonist Edward Winslow and the Wampanoag diplomat Habamoak as they entered the Pocasset town of Mattapoisett on the banks of the Titicet or Tanton River. All were preoccupied with the illness that had overcome a beloved man, Usamequin, or Massasoit, his title, a great sachem of the Wampanoags, and leader of the adjacent region of Poconoket. Hundreds gathered at Usamequin's council house, and both Habamoak and Winslow were en route to pay their respects, a commendable indigenous custom in this land. As Winslow noted in Good News from New England, this Pocasset leader, however, had remained at Mattapoisett, perhaps to begin cultivating the fields, process the spring fish, or look after children and elders who required care. A gunshot had sounded beyond the river just prior to Winslow's arrival, putting the leader on edge, prepared to defend those kin who also remained. From the well-worn path ahead, the leader may have heard heavy English boots or Habamoak's voice, lamenting and singing Usamequin's praises. Winslow later reported that a rumor had circulated that Usamequin had already passed away. Indeed, their diversion to Mattapoisett was in part necessitated by his concern that the sachem of this town, a man who held a much more suspicious view of the English settlers who had so recently planted on the Wampanoag coast, would succeed Usamequin. Upon entering Mattapoisett, Winslow approached the great Sagamo Komoko, the council house where leaders deliberated, where the sachem and his family lived and hosted guests. However, he quickly discovered that Konbitant, the sachem, was not at home, but at Poconoket, tending to Usamequin and his kin. Instead, Winslow remarked he was greeted and given friendly entertainment by the squaw sachem, translating to an audience in England, for so they called the sachem's wife. This was his mistranslation, song squaw, or sagam squaw, was not simply the word for spouse, but rather the word for female leader, suggesting that this woman who entertained him was perhaps more than Konbitant's wife, particularly given that by local custom she would have come from a leadership family. The song squaw must have carried a legitimate suspicion of this English newcomer who, by his own account, had raised a gun at her and her family during the previous year's spring gathering at Namasket, a neighboring Wampanoag town, acting rashly on false rumors that Konbitant had killed Plymouth's interpreter to Squantum. Indeed, that spring, on the return journey home from Poconoket, Konbitant would raise this encounter when Winslow assured him of Plymouth's good intentions, asking, "If your love is so great and it grows such good fruits, why is it that when you come to our places or we go to yours, you stand as if ready to fight, with the mouth of your gun pointed at us?" Yet despite the gun Winslow carried, the song squaw responded to his arrival with diplomacy. She hosted Winslow and his small party, offering hospitality, food, and rest, as well as assistance and information. When she allowed Winslow to hire one of her runners to seek news from Poconoket of Usamequin's status, Perhaps this impulse arose in part from her awareness of the danger of rumors in Winslow's hands, but it also arose from her responsibility as a leader, a choice she made about how to deal with this stranger in her space. Her response was emblematic of the ways in which Native leaders often acted as diplomatic hosts to unexpected European guests. Indeed, 2 years before, the Wabanaki leader, Samoset of Pemaquid, far up the coast, had greeted the startled newcomers at Patuxet, or Plymouth, in their language, saying, "Welcome, Englishmen." This reflected not only Indigenous diplomacy, but experience with over 100 years of trade, cultural and linguistic exchange, as well as violence, disease, and captivity with Englishmen and other Western Europeans on the coast. Indeed, Samoset was one of many Wabanaki and Wampanoag men who had been captured by European explorers, learning a new language by necessity, and in his case, returning to serve as an intercultural diplomat. This exchange was not new to the Wampanoags or Wabanakis, who also had been traveling by canoe to exchange with each other for millennia. What was new about this encounter was that these Englishmen had come to stay, marking a discernible move from extractive colonialism, including the harvesting of trees and fish and the capture of indigenous bodies, to settler colonialism. These newcomers also carried a vision that Englishmen would replace the indigenous people, including women planters, as the rightful inhabitants of this land. Winslow's is the only account of this important woman in the Puritan narratives. She was a leader, the wife of Convitant, and a relation to many. She experienced the arrival of the newcomers and their incorporation into native networks of exchange and diplomacy. She hosted Winslow and other leaders at her large home. Like other women, she cultivated and sustained the fields that fed the families. She felt the dire impacts of the diseases that ravaged her relations. Living through the epidemics and the first wave of colonization, she experienced unimaginable grief and loss. Yet she birthed and raised at least two daughters, Weetamoo, or Namumpum, and Wutanakanusk, who survived several epidemics as well as threats of violence to mature into leaders among their communities. Yet in Winslow's account, the significant mother and leader was not even named. Although well remembered within native New England communities, like her mother, Weetamoo has often not been named in the histories and literatures of early America, despite her prominent leadership role. Weetamoo emerged as the Song Squaw of Pocasset after Convitant's death, recognized by Usamequin as his relation and true heir to the Pocasset sachemship. In fact, the title of this book is taken from Usamequin's description of Weetamoo as our beloved cousin and kinswoman. An influential Wampanoag diplomat, Weetamoo presented a political and cultural challenge to the Puritan men who confronted her authority. Her strategic adaptation to the colonial deed game enabled her to protect more land than nearly any surrounding leader, a history explored in Chapter 1. She married Wamsutta, Usamequin's eldest son, in a dual marriage alliance with her sister, Wutanakanusk, and Wamsutta's brother, Po Metacomet, more commonly known as Metacom or Philip. She played a key role and forged alliances during the infamous colonial conflict known as King Philip's War. One Puritan chronicler portrayed her as potent a prince as any round about her, with as much corn, land, and men at her command, as Metacom, insisting he was much more forward in the design and had greater success than King Philip himself. Yet in many histories of the war, she is relegated to a trivial role in comparison to Metacom or colonial leaders such as Plymouth Governor Josiah Winslow, Edward's son. Even recent scholarly accounts mention her briefly, a footnote to history. Weetamoo's striking presence in primary documents and her conspicuous absence from many secondary sources led me down a long, winding road of historical recovery. Tellingly, this process began with a simple question regarding the role of women leaders in King Philip's War. However, the deeper I dug, the more I found myself pursuing a decolonizing process of expanding the strategies through which we might do the work of history, which in the Abenaki language is called onsmongmongon, a cyclical activity of recalling and relaying in which we are collectively engaged. Thus, if you are listening to this audiobook or viewing it on a screen, I am asking you to follow these strands and storylines with me. I am saying welcome, although I will warn you that, for some, this landscape may seem unfamiliar and unsettling. Others, of course, may find it strikingly familiar. I acknowledge that it may be difficult to follow me at times, yet if you come in the manner of a guest to the place world I've created and immerse yourself, as I have, in the documents and maps of our history, I hope your participation may be rewarded with the gift of seeing a world we all inhabit with greater insight and clarity. This book also focuses on the recovery of the Nipmuc scholar James Printer, another compelling figure absent from most histories, who was accused of revolt during King Philip's War. Wawas, or James, was from a leading family in the Nipmuc mission community, or praying town, of Hassinamisit. After attending English preparatory schools in the Massachusetts colony, James became an apprentice to Cambridge printer Samuel Green and helped usher in American publishing history. He worked the first printing press in New England, which was housed in the Harvard Indian College, another project of historical recovery covered in depth in Chapter 2. Here, the man henceforth known as James Printer set the type on the first Bible printed in North America. Printer adapted to a changing and challenging environment, using his linguistic skills to survive the ravages of war, serving as a scribe and negotiator for native leaders, and leveraging his invaluable talent to negotiate his way back to the press. He went on to serve as a leader at Hassinamisit, enabling the protection of Nipmuc lands and the survival of his kin and community. Laboring at the Harvard Press after the war, he set the type for one of the first publications by a woman in the English colonies, a text that would become a classic of American literature. In the process, he encountered himself in the print. He was not only the printer of The Sovereignty and Goodness of God, a narrative of the captivity and restoration of Mrs. Mary Rowlandson, but a character within it, credited with helping to negotiate the redemption of the Puritan mistress Mary Rowlandson by her and his own hand. Both the Nipmuc printer and the Puritan mistress survived King Philip's War, but the conflict upended their lives. Both experienced forms of captivity and restoration. As Jill Lepore observes, however, the lasting legacy of Mary Rowlandson's dramatic, eloquent, and fantastically popular narrative of captivity and redemption is the nearly complete veil it has unwillingly placed over the experience of bondage endured by Algonquin Indians during King Philip's War. Captivity has most often been seen as a condition faced by settlers, particularly women and children. Until recently, as Pauline Strong relays, scholars often neglected or distorted the Native American context of captivity. Margaret Newell notes that we still know more about the relatively few Euro-American captives among the Indians than we do about the thousands of Native Americans who were enslaved. This absence, as both Newell and Strong suggest, is particularly grievous when we consider that, in numerical terms, the captivity of English colonists among Indians pales in comparison to the abduction, imprisonment, and enslavement of Indians by the English, and indeed to the captivity of Indians by Indians during the colonial period. For example, In August 1675, James Printer was captured by colonial forces and falsely accused of participating in a raid on Rowlandson's town of Lancaster, Massachusetts. Although he ultimately averted conviction, establishing that he was in church, James was imprisoned for a month in a Boston jail and barely escaped lynching by an English mob, a story relayed in full in Chapter 5. 5 months later, James's brother traveled 80 miles on snowshoes to deliver a warning to ministers at Cambridge that another raid on Lancaster was imminent. However, Massachusetts military leaders did not respond quickly enough, and in February 1776, Mary Rowlandson was captured by Narragansett men during a winter raid. As detailed in Chapter 7, Mary was carried to the Nipmuc stronghold of Menemisset, where she encountered James and his extended family held in captivity, according to missionary Daniel Gookin, by their own relations. In an intriguing twist of fate, at Menemisset, Rowlandson was given to Weetamoo, whom she followed deep into the interior of Nipmuc and Wabanaki countries as the Sunk Squaw sought protective sanctuaries for families evading colonial troops. Years later, in 1682, as James set the type on Rowlandson's narrative, he helped preserve the most detailed portrait of Weetamoo and her movements in the colonial record. As historian Neil Salisbury has insisted, our understanding of the cross-cultural dimensions of captivity will remain incomplete until the stories of the James Printers and Weetamoos throughout American history are fully fleshed out and placed alongside more familiar narratives like Rowlandson's. This book seeks to answer his charge. All too often, histories of war focus on male soldiers and warriors, the victories and losses of captains, generals, and chiefs. In drawing James and Weetamoo's stories together, a different picture of war, captivity, and resistance arises, one that reveals the determination of a mother who was a valiant leader and the compromises of an erudite scholar who became a diplomat and scribe. These stories reverse the narrative of absence and reveal the persistence of Indigenous adaptation and survival. As Anishinaabe historian Jean O'Brien and others have observed, American readers have often been drawn to the national narrative of the vanishing Indian, including the death of Native leaders like Philip, rather than the more complex stories of Native adaptation, as with James Printer. The persistent narrative of extinction to which O'Brien refers has falsely educated New Englanders and Americans for generations, engendering a mythological history in which the English and their American descendants replace Indians in the land. Likewise, in writing about King Philip's War, colonial ministers and magistrates sought to contain Indigenous resistance within narratives that would justify their replacement. Following colonial structures, many authors and historians have also contained such wars within an orderly chain of events or thesis argument. A decolonial process might reverse that trend by resisting containment and opening possibilities for Native presence, as exemplified by the expansive and connective approach of Chapter 6, where multiple narratives intertwine. This book seeks to focus narrowly at times on the alternative stories revealed by tracking Weetamoo, James Printer, and their network of relations, while at other times expanding far beyond that scope to vast Indigenous geographies, including the Wabanaki Northern Front, where many Native people sought refuge from colonization and war. The book is organized episodically to offer scenarios like the encounter between Winslow and Weetamoo's mother and insights for contemplation and critical reflection. Section breaks and subheads signal a pause in the narrative, offering an opportunity for deliberation. Language. Naming war. One of the most crucial lenses to viewing history anew is Indigenous language, a vastly underutilized archive of place names and concepts. A new generation of Hawaiian scholars, some trained in the Kapapahana Kaiapuni immersion schools, is bringing forth a revolutionary understanding of the historical relationship between Hawaii and the United States based on a vast archive of Hawaiian newspapers and documents which past historians have largely ignored, in part because they lack literacy in the language. Our understanding of Wampanoag and New England history will be transformed as a new generation of Wampanoag speakers, led by Jesse Little Doe Baird, turns the lens of language on the body of place names and understudied Wampanoag language texts. Language keepers are among the most important scholars we have with us today. Their insights into a single word can reveal layers of history which we cannot understand from documents alone. As a student of Abenaki language and a scholar of history, I have benefited tremendously from conversations with language keepers in northern New England, such as Roger Paul, Carol Dana, the late Cecile Wawanalet, her son, Eli Jobert, and her student, Jesse Bruchek, as well as language keepers and tribal scholars in southern New England like Jesse Little Doe Baird, Bettina Washington, Linda Combs, Elizabeth James Perry, Jonathan Perry, Cheryl Hawley, Pam Ellis, Stephanie Fielding, and Melissa Tantaquijan Zobel. My understanding of Indigenous language is only that of a student, not of a fluent speaker. But being able to understand the nuances of language has at times shed remarkable light on the historical landscape. The war in which Weetamoo and James Printer became embroiled would not have been known to them in any language as King Philip's War. As Jenny Pulsifer notes, that appellation arose only in the 18th century, perhaps with the publication of Benjamin Church's Entertaining History of King Philip's War. Thomas Church published his father's boisterous memoir in 1716, 40 years after Benjamin Church led a company to capture and kill Metacom. If Custer had survived the Battle of Little Bighorn, he may have relayed a similar account of that war. Church's narrative formally marked the end of the conflict with his own successful containment of Metacom. The hyperbolic narrative implied that it was Church's leadership and tracking skills that enabled his company to locate and ensnare the elusive Wampanoag Salcom, even though Church acknowledged that a Pocasset Wampanoag man, Alderman, struck the fatal blow. Naming the conflict King Philip's War created an impression of finality. The Indigenous rebellion had been squashed with the death of Philip, the subjugation complete, titles cleared. This act of naming contained the war from an ongoing, multifaceted Indigenous resistance led by an uncontainable network of Indigenous leaders and families to a rebellion, an event that could be contained within 1 year by a single persuasive insurgent who had taken his exit and vanished. As Lepore notes in her landmark work on the narratives of King Philip's War, names of wars are always biased. They always privilege one perspective over another. In New England, when the first narratives of the war emerged, the conflict was known more broadly as the War with the Indians in New England, as Massachusetts Minister Increase Mather entitled it, or the Indian War, as Rhode Island leader John Easton and Massachusetts merchant Nathaniel Saltonstall described it. Later, this struggle would be acknowledged as part of a longer engagement, the First Indian War, the beginning of resistance against increasing English expansion that continued in the northern Wabanaki country for the next 100 years. Indeed, the Mohegan leader Owenico, who led an influential company of Mohegan scouts for the English in this first war and those that followed, referred to this conflict as the Wars with the General Nations of Indians, suggesting a series of wars waged by the English with a regional alliance of Native nations. This Mohegan naming may be the most accurate. Moreover, most of the Native people who were impacted by this war would have named the conflict in their own languages. To them, and for many Native people today, this was not New England, but Ndakina, to use the Abenaki word, our land, the place to which we belong. This is a word that denotes kinship, similar to Nigowis, our mother. Long before it was reinscribed as New England, this place was named Wampanoag or Wabanaki, the land where the sun is born every day. the tribal names Wabanaki and Wampanoag reflect an originary embeddedness in this land, as well as the first people's responsibility to welcome the sun's emergence and return. Wabanaki and Wampanoag people are born of and continually born into this easternmost place. While neighboring Native nations use these terms to describe the nations the English termed Indians of New England, they called themselves simply the people, the human beings, Anunnabik in Abenaki. When introducing themselves, the people would have acknowledged the families and places to which they belonged, like James Printer's town of Hassanamisit, in the Nipmuc or freshwater interior,
or Weetamoo's homeland of Pocasset on the coast.
Likewise, Native people in the Northeast had multiple names for war. In Western Abenaki, with which I am most familiar, Awondomongon is an activity in which people are engaged, a state of being which is temporary. In this language, there is a distinction between being caught up or immersed in a conflict. Metonbek, or Aoden, we are fighting, we are in war, and to wage war against something or someone.
Nedawodamen, or Nansekans.
There are also multiple words that refer to counselor warriors, such as Nisisok in Wampanoag and Kinonbok in Abenaki, both of which translate more precisely to those who have the courage to pursue difficult courses, similar to words that describe steep terrain. Edward Winslow acknowledged that the Nises are men of great courage and wisdom, among the Salcom's council, who would endure most hardness and yet are more discreet, courteous, and humane in their carriage than any amongst them. One of the most intriguing questions raised by the study of language is to consider which name of war, a man like James Printer, a woman like Weetamoo, a Nisa like Habamok, or Metacom himself would have used to describe the conflict in which they found themselves entangled, and which Metacom was accused by the English of waging. Native languages also have precise and complex terms for peace, and this book, especially in its final chapters, highlights the processes and places of peacemaking that the existing narratives of war obscure. Re-envisioning narrative fields. Both Jill Lepore and Amy Din Auden, among others, have highlighted the important role of narration in establishing accounts of war and legal justification for settler colonialism in New England. Din Auden provides an incisive, if somewhat ironic, comment by Peter Halm. The particular difficulty associated with the establishment of the European colonies concerned what might be called the planting of a narrative, the hacking away of enough surrounding weeds to let flourish a narrative field in which the colonists could settle themselves. Among the goals of this book is to provide, reveal, and restore alternative narrative fields, which have sometimes arisen quite unexpectedly from the archive of colonial documents, like weeds breaking through soil into that well-established field. Perhaps this unsettling process in which I have engaged could be better described as allowing multifaceted plants to emerge into the narrative field, transforming that field into a narrative swamp, which requires different kinds of navigation or reading practices. Reading in the archive. When I embarked on this project, I thought it would focus on recovering the stories of James Printer and Weetamoo, revealing different perspectives on the war, and it does. I thought this book would be about reading narratives of the war like Mary Rowlandson's text anew, and it is. I believe that extending our historical vision to include the vast land of the Northern Front was crucial to understanding the war and its aftermath, and that proved true. What I did not know at the outset was how much new material would be revealed by focusing so closely on the lives of James, Weetamoo, their families, and those who traveled north. So much had already been written about the war, so many archives mined by historians. I did not realize how many more documents would arise in the process of research that previous historians had not located or acknowledged. I could not have anticipated how such documents would challenge and unsettle the narratives of the war. So many of the histories that have been written about King Philip's War over the last two centuries rely on the veracity of the narratives written by 17th century colonial military and religious leaders such as Increase Mather, William Hubbard, and Benjamin Church. Yet I found many instances where these foundational narratives are either not supported or entirely contradicted by primary records from the precise time and place about which they were written. For example, the oft-cited, contradictory narratives of the death of Weetamoo's husband, the Wampanoag, Wamsata, are undermined by the records of the Plymouth Court. The accounts, written post-war, emphasize a suspected collusion between Wamsata and the Narragansetts, which led the Plymouth colonial government to capture Wamsata. Mather and Hubbard place Wamsata's capture and death, by either illness or poisoning, within a larger narrative of long-standing Indigenous rebellion and conspiracy. In particular, Mather offered his account as proof of the notoriously known jealousies of the Narragansetts and Wampanoags. However, the court documents reveal that rather than conspiracy with the neighboring Narragansetts, Plymouth's real concern was Wamsata's purported land deals with settlers in the competing colony of Rhode Island. Land stands at the center of those narratives. Mather's history of the war opens with a clear claim to the land he called New England, portraying Indigenous people as interlopers in a divinely gifted space. The Boston minister asserted that the heathen people amongst whom we live and whose land the Lord God of our fathers hath given to us for a rightful possession have at sundry times been plotting mischievous devices against that part of the English Israel which is seated in these goings down of the sun. No man that is an inhabitant of any considerable standing can be ignorant. Mather's geographic orientation is revealing. While Wampanoag and Wabanaki people recognized this region as the land of the dawn, Mather regarded New England as a place seated in the going down of the sun. For native people, this was the easternmost land, a place of origins. For English settlers, this was their final resting place, the end of their journey to a remote place to the west of their home. Yet it was also a birthplace for them, a new England, a new Israel that would provide a fertile ground in which to plant their fields and raise their sons. The problem, as we will see herein, is that another people were already planting here, and they had their own new generations to cultivate, their long-standing responsibilities to this land holding greater weight than the promise of a distant Lord God. While ancient planting fields and bonds of reciprocity rooted the Wampanoag, Narragansett, Nipmuc, and Wabanaki families deeply in these places, men like Mather also claimed a rightful possession to these lands, which they imagined had been granted them by a higher authority. At this intersection of competing claims, rights and responsibilities often conflicted. The puzzle that is both perplexing and disturbing to unpack, if our orientation is east, is the way in which men like Mather sought to portray the practice and defense of those long-standing Indigenous responsibilities to land and kin as a mischievous plot against the English Israel, which had planted itself amongst them. The records also reveal a much more complex role for Weetamoo. In Mather's post-war narrative of Wamsata's capture, she is reduced to a scorned wife, who erroneously believes her husband had been poisoned by settlers. In general, colonial narrators downplayed her role and the conflicts between the colonies while building a narrative of Indian treachery. But in the documents, she appears as a diplomat and leader who strategically manipulated and circumvented Plymouth's interests in her lands in order to protect them. Two overlooked manuscript letters concerning Weetamoo, explored in Chapter 3, shed new light on the origins of King Philip's War. John Easton, the Quaker governor of Rhode Island, composed a letter to Plymouth Governor Josiah Winslow 1 month before the outbreak of war, detailing Weetamoo's concerns regarding Plymouth Colony's encroachment on her lands and urging Winslow to restrain this imposition on the Queen's right. Rather than addressing her pressing concerns, Winslow himself wrote to Weetamoo on the eve of war, hoping to persuade the influential leader to remain neutral. The letter makes clear Winslow's intent to contain Metacom, a neighboring Salcom, and Weetamoo's brother-in-law. Both letters illuminate the context of the causes of war in striking ways, as well as the reluctance of later historians to acknowledge the importance of Weetamoo's leadership or the strategies Plymouth pursued in its invasion of Metacom's stronghold, thus homing in on two extraordinary but neglected actors, Weetamoo and James Printer, led me not only to recover crucial documents, but to uncover a radically different narrative field. Reading scenarios. In my research, I also focused on reading the primary sources closely for what was happening on the ground, interpreting actions against statements, reading depictions of geography, paying close attention to behavior, movements, and exchanges. Influenced by Diana Taylor's The Archive and the Repertoire and approaches from Native literary studies, I considered the scenarios contained within primary documents, reading people's actions in places of cultural and ecological significance through a culturally specific lens. In writing, I also sought to imaginatively reconstruct these place worlds. This style may be especially evident beginning with Chapter 4, on the opening of the war, where storytelling evokes the interruptive, chaotic nature of war, even as critical close reading sheds light on events and causes. This process was enabled by language study, dwelling on a place name or title, or utilizing multiple language resources to recover a more accurate conceptualization of a practice like tribute or a category like captive. But it also entailed reading texts, such as deeds, within a network of related documents. For example, one mistake that historians sometimes make is to assume that a court grant can be read as the beginning of colonial settlement, or as a marker of legitimacy. In contrast, I would often find that a grant issued by the Plymouth or Massachusetts court did not lead to immediate settlement, but rather to protests by native people who inhabited those places. Sometimes the resistance to improvement was overt, such as dismantling built structures or assaulting livestock. In other cases, it was a matter of discerning the evidence of continued inhabitation and signs of protecting lands against encroachment. Often statements made in court years later demonstrated that although English people claimed title, Indigenous people continued to inhabit, cultivate, and know land as their own, retaining their ancestral rights and responsibilities. Reading the land as archive. Likewise, a large part of the research for this project has entailed walking, paddling, and driving through the places where these events took place. The land itself is an archive that demands interpretation. My own education often involved my father, along with Abenaki community leaders like Lenny Lampman, Louise Lampman Larrivee, Lester Lampman, and Larry LePen, and my tracking mentor, Gordon Russell, taking me out on the land and showing me the stories it has to tell. Those excursions entailed learning to recognize the rocks that revealed the remains of homes and council houses, understanding how apple trees planted by grandmothers were still feeding deer, which in turn were still feeding families through the winter, and learning to read the flow of the river in rapids and trout pools, or, as I learned from Wampanoag tribal historians, seeing the cliffs where councils were held at Metacom's stronghold of Montauk. These ancient and ongoing places all have stories attached to them, features that evoke memories, embed oral traditions, and map subsistence and survival and that can reveal acute insight into a historical document. My teachers in Abenaki country consistently emphasize the importance of oral history, learned on the land and at the kitchen table. When I began this project, I imagined the same might be true in southern New England, but I learned that I had as much to learn from Wampanoag readings of the documents as I did from hearing oral histories. When I visited Massachusetts and Rhode Island, out came books, illuminating readings of the printed word, laced with ironic humor about all of the misguided interpretations that have been published over the years. We have a tendency to think of Native people, of the past and even of the present, as oral cultures. But this characterization fails to account for adaptation. The Wampanoags and their neighbors swiftly and adeptly adopted reading and the culture of the book in the 17th century, making them a highly literate people. Moreover, these communities have been engaged with the historical record for multiple generations, producing analysis, synthesis, and knowledge, which is informed by their oral traditions. Consultation and exchange regarding the interpretation of documents, places, actions, and motivations is an ongoing process in which I am engaged, a process that will never be complete. Thus, as you reach the end of this book, you will encounter more openings than closures, inviting the process of research, recovery, and exchange to continue. My own obsession with land and place, swamps and rivers, led to many hours immersed in maps as I strove to comprehend routes of movement, tracked particular places, and attempted to reconstruct subsistence and recreate the historical space in my mind. The maps would inevitably lead me back to those swamps and rivers where my legs would become snagged in brambles, my feet wet and muddy. In southern New England, one of the greatest challenges was figuring out how to access and understand places that had been radically transformed by colonialism and industrial development. I encountered a stark difference in southern New England than what I had previously experienced in northern New England. Whereas so much of our forested land in Wabanaki has either been sustained or recovered, in Wampanoag country, the development is overwhelming. In some places, erasing any traces of the indigenous landscape that preceded it. I will never forget the experience of traveling to Mattapoisett in Somerset, Massachusetts, where Weetamoo grew up, to find a massive power plant overshadowing the entire peninsula. Acknowledging the stories of our ancestors. In my travels, I realized that it was my own unique family that has compelled me to tell this story anew. The most obvious is my father's influence, teaching me to read the land and waterways, to understand the depth of history that lies within the land, to laugh at our human fallibility in the face of so much power. Still, the more I wrote, the more I realized that an equally strong influence came from the stories I heard from my cherished Babcha, my mother's mother. At the beginning of World War II, my grandmother found her family suddenly displaced by a war in which she had no commanding role and no power of resistance. She lived on a farm in rural Poland with her parents, three young children, and my grandfather, who once pulled a plow by the strength of his broad shoulders when the oxen gave out. They were displaced from their home by opposing armies, coming from both Russia and Germany. And she soon found herself separated from her husband, her parents, and her siblings as she and her children were transported on cattle cars, often in bitter cold, between Nazi labor camps. Babcha was a phenomenal storyteller, and her harrowing tales have stayed with me. Her ability to strategize in the midst of chaos was astounding and led to the survival of seven children, three of whom were born during the war, including my mother. I know that but for the strength and intelligence of this woman who never had a formal education, I would not be here. Yet among the most important realizations I drew from her stories was that for most people in the world, war simply arrives at their door, an unwelcome invader. It is not the carefully orchestrated series of causes, effects, strategies, and events that historians often construct in the aftermath. For most people, war is a relentless storm that arrives without warning, a swirl of chaos that upends their lives in untold ways. For most mothers and many fathers, the goal of war is merely striving to ensure that their children will survive. Inevitably, this understanding shapes my reading of the documents as much as my training as a scholar. Rather than striving for objectivity, I've taken a cue from my grandmother and father. I aim to strive for integrity in my research and interpretation, and pursue a relentless determination to document the strategies of survival. I acknowledge and even cultivate a sense of embeddedness, rather than distance, through my writing. In doing so, I draw on and respect the language of this land, which privileges participation. This includes using writing as a tool, and this book is an awikigan to draw you into this native space, to use the techniques of storytelling to draw you into place worlds with the goal of deeper understanding. Opening the door to Weetamoo's story meant understanding her as a mother, a sister, and a leader responsible for protecting all of her beloved kin. Likewise, James Printer's story revealed his family's remarkable efforts to find sanctuary for their relations when it seemed that no place in their homeland was safe. This project also changed when I became a mother, transformed by my newfound understanding of the lengths to which a parent will go to protect a single life. It brought not only deeper understanding of the actions of Weetamoo and James Printer, but also, quite unexpectedly, of Mary Rowlandson, and most assuredly, of those ancestors who found refuge in the North Country and survived. Prologue. Kaskowak, the Place of Peace. The Queen of Kaskowak, Casco Bay, 1623. It was spring, the salmon streaming upriver, when English explorer and colonial agent Christopher Levitt arrived at Kaskowak, the place of herons, in Wabanaki, the land of the dawn. Wabanaki leaders greeted him, hosted his visit, and diplomatically opened the way through the extensive coastal region. The leaders of Kaskowak invited Levitt to remain, and he recounted the Queen of Kwak formally welcomed him, his men, and the fishermen who came to her homeland. The woman or reputed queen asked me if those men were my friends. I told her they were. Then she drank to them and told them they were welcome to her country, and so should all my friends be at any time. She drank also to her husband and bid him welcome to her country too. For you must understand that her father was the sagamore of this place and left it to her at his death, having no more children. In welcoming Levitt into her country, the queen initiated a diplomatic relationship. She spoke on behalf of a community, a gathering of extended families bound to each other through long-standing inhabitation, intermarriage, and interdependent relationships. The people who belonged to this place included those whose ties reached back through oral tradition and kinship to time immemorial, as well as others, like her husband, Kogowisko, who had been incorporated through marriage or adoption. Belonging entailed not only residency, but kinship to a particular place and people, of which the Sogmole, Sagamore, or Solcom, or Sogsquaw, Sonk Squaw, was the symbolic leader. The queen's leadership may have seemed anomalous to Levitt, explained by the apparent lack of male heirs. But Sonk Squawk, or female leaders, were not uncommon, particularly in communities reliant upon horticulture, where oral traditions emphasized the power of women. evidence of women's labor and management in cultivating fields and allowing some to lie fallow, was all around Levitt, who witnessed a great quantity of cleared ground from his position on the coastal waterways. Located near the northeasternmost limits of horticulture, the people of Kaskawak occupied a critical position in a distributive trade network mediating between planting communities and northerly kin who relied on hunting, fishing, and gathering. Sogamok and Sogsquaw were responsible for ensuring distribution of resources within their homelands and between territories through a well-established ceremonial and economic system of exchange. A breakdown in the redistributive system could yield conflict, particularly in times of scarcity. Therefore, effective leaders facilitated the renewal of relationships and amelioration of disputes through diplomatic councils and annual ceremonies at places like Kaskawak, where people of all ages participated in symbolic and material exchange, celebrating inter-community marriages, relaying deep time stories, sharing artistic and practical knowledge, and negotiating rights and responsibilities among contiguous communities, thus enabling social and ecological sustainability. Diplomatic negotiation was crucial at this juncture as Wabanaki communities increasingly encountered European vessels and fledgling fishing and trading settlements on their coast, imposing a different system of exchange. At the same time, foreign diseases devastated native communities. These transformations ushered in a time of great grief and change where conflict could abound. Exchange was vital to diplomacy. Wabanaki men were already traveling between Kitsiteku, the St. Lawrence River, and the coast, participating in an extensive inland and maritime trade network, which included both Indigenous people and French, English, and Basque visitors. They adapted their language to accommodate the trade and even commanded European shallops. Some of their relations had been taken captive by English and French men, carried away in ships, far from their homes and their kin. Thus, Wabanaki leaders understood that there were dangers inherent to their interactions with European visitors and vessels. The Queen's diplomacy was designed to bring both neighboring leaders and newcomers into right relations. Levitt participated in such a diplomatic council at the Indigenous meeting place of Costco Bay with Wabanaki leaders from the region, who expressed a desire to bring him and his family into their kinship network. He humorously expressed that he was not a little proud to be adopted cousin to so many great kings at one instant, but did willingly accept of it. In this world, one could not inhabit a place without belonging to a particular family. And as Levitt witnessed at Kaskawak, this belonging could be cultivated. The Queen explained that her husband belonged through marriage, and Levitt himself was offered a place within her family and territory. However, these relationships also entailed commitment. Whether Levitt realized it or not, his acceptance came with responsibilities. The problem, of course, was that English guests all too often misinterpreted such hospitality. When the Queen said they were welcome to her country, she did not mean they were welcome to possess it. Nor did she mean that the English and French fishermen were welcome to harvest all the fish from the sea, an abundance they misunderstood as endless. Having lived in this place for so long, dependent upon it for their survival, the people of Kaskawak understood through experience the complex of belief, practice, story, and ceremony that enabled them to sustain balance among finite resources. This included the crucial role of leaders like the Queen in ensuring fair distribution at Kaskawak, a place name that conveyed a meeting of multiple tributaries and nations, a site of diplomacy and exchange. When the Queen welcomed Levitt and his friends into this space, she invited them to enter into its network of people, diplomatic practices, and reciprocal relations. It was up to him and those that followed to reveal whether they would abide with them and share in the first mother's power and strength, or fall among the brutes who would steal her body and refuse to share in it as she had intended. A Rebalancing, Kaskowak, 1631. Christopher Levitt acknowledged that the Native nations had a natural right of inheritance and received praise from local leaders for acting in a right fashion, but others posed a direct challenge to the system of reciprocal relations. For example, Walter Bagnall, the first European to settle in Casco Bay, displayed little regard for either indigenous rights or the protocols of exchange. In 1628, he set up a trading post on Richmond Island and became infamous for hoarding goods and repeatedly cheating Wabanaki people in trade. Bagnall neglected to acquire title from either his own government or local indigenous leaders, but became wealthy through deception and extortion. In the Wabanaki world, such behavior represented the worst of infractions against the community. In 1631, Skittery Gusset, whom Levitt had acknowledged as a local sagamore, killed Bagnall and burned down his trading post, enacting a violent redistribution and asserting jurisdiction in this diplomatic space. A Bushel of Corn, Owascoag, 1659. Skittery Gusset belonged to a wide network of related leaders along the coast who participated in negotiations that led to deeds, often signed by multiple representatives. He was the first to appear on a deed for land at Kaskowak, in which fisherman Francis Small acquired the right to settle land from the marshes and uplands of Kapisik to the fishing falls at Amankongon on the south side of the Presumpscot River, between the contemporary Four River and Cumberland Mills. Small pledged an annual pay of one trading coat, a symbolic recognition of Skittery Gusset's leadership, and 1 gallon of liquor. The exchange of wampum and tobacco, as Small later testified, in this and subsequent agreements, sealed a pledge to share space, creating a negotiated relationship as much as an economic transaction. He later sold the rights to part of this tract, including a mill privilege at Kapisik, to John Phillips, who transferred it to his son-in-law, George Munjoy, both of whom had come to Costco from Boston. In 1666, Skittery Gusset's sister, the Song Squaw, Werribita, signed a deed with another leader, Nanateonet, allowing Munjoy to extend his claim to the other side of the Presumpscot from the lowermost planting ground of Amankongon to the Great Falls at Sakarapa, Westbrook, an area far from the English settlements clustered on the coast. 4 years later, Werribita, known also as Jane or Joan, apparently consented to a local colonial land grant at Casco Bay to Anthony Brackett for 20 shillings with her brother, Sagatawan, who had married into a leadership family to the south on the Saco and Kennebunk rivers. Werribita and Skittery Gusset also appear on deeds with leaders to the north, including Moxus, Sheepscot John, and the influential Androscoggin leader the English called Robin Hood. Documents such as these often recognize the intersecting relationships and jurisdictions of neighboring sachems in the coastal region. At Owascoag, just south of Kaskowak, where Werribita and her mother lived and planted, they had allowed a group of settlers, represented by Andrew and Arthur Alger, to live among them. This produced the earliest record in which Werribita appeared. The documented agreement between Werribita's family and the Alger brothers is typical of deeds in this region, although more revealing than many of those recorded in Plymouth, where indigenous rights were often subsumed. In the document dated September 1659, Jane, alias Eponym, declared that she, her mother, namely Nagwasquaw, the wife of Wick Werewask, Sagamore, and her brother Skitterigusset, who may have died by this time, had co-equally 8 years previously sold unto Andrew Alger and to his brother Arthur Alger a tract of land on the Awaskawak River, Scarborough. The deed reveals patterns of contiguous and overlapping inhabitation and resource use that had to be negotiated in order to maintain peaceful relations. The deed recognized the name of the river in Indian, while naming several places that denoted recent settlement, such as the Great Hill of Abram Jocelyn's, probably Orchard Hill. It also recognized the right of Werribita and her mother to continue to plant in this territory, so long as they both live. Most important, the agreement required the Algers to give one bushel of corn for acknowledgement every year, so long as they both shall live. This annual bushel of corn, recurrently pledged on deeds and treaties, was similar to the contribution a native family would be obliged to make to their community. Rather than simply acquiring an outright purchase, the Algers engaged in an agreement by which they, too, could belong to this place. Through their annual acknowledgement to the local family leaders, enacting a formalized relationship to the land and its long-standing communities. Eponym, translated to our sister or our woman, acted as speaker for the extended leadership family, acknowledging that the agreement had been in place since 1651. Werribita reaffirmed the agreement again in 1672, 3 years before her death and the commencement of the war. While Werribita was party to multiple deeds over these decades between 1651 and 1675, the 1659 Owaskawak deed bears close examination, revealing a great deal about the larger context of diplomatic negotiations and conceptualizations of relationships among people and places. Owaskawak was the place of good grass, and the name may have translated more precisely to Olaskikak, or sweet grass gathering place. This was the grass, known to some Algonquin nations as the hair of Mother Earth, a sacred plant used in ceremonies, art, basketry, and medicine, that is uniquely adapted to annual summer harvesting. Sweet grass flourishes in brackish marshes, which were and are often tied to particular family territories. Owaskawak was likely the place where Werribita and her family handpicked the blades of grass, distributing carefully woven braids and baskets among the networks to which they belonged. This was also a place where they planted our mother corn, a practice clearly continuing here even as settlers, like the Algers, began their own plantings. Oral traditions relay that the corn mother, known in story and song as Nigoes, our mother, instructed that her own body be planted in order to feed her starving children, the Wabanaki people. And it was unlikely that Werribita and her mother planted alone. Like other native women, they must have shared the fields with their female relations. Naming here was important as well. The name given to Werribita and Skitterigusset's mother was Nagwasquaw, which may have been an anglicized spelling of Nigoes, with the gendered ending squaw, recognizing our mother's right to continue to harvest and plant in this place. Thus the deed recognized Owaskawag as the place of our mother on multiple levels, where our mother lived, planted, and was planted, harvested and was harvested, to enable the peacemaking protocols for which Kaskuak was well known. Like their predecessor, the Queen, these leaders of Kaskuak were entrusted with diplomacy. Thus, part of their role was to create responsible relationships with the newcomers. With this agreement, they gave the Algers and their extended family permission to live at Owaskawak. but negotiated some of the terms of sharing space and required acknowledgement of their continuing relationship to and leadership in this place. As Alice Nash has observed, such deeds should be read more like proto-treaties or councils in which rights, land use, and jurisdiction were negotiated, rather than as simple property transactions. This agreement was made at harvest time, when both the Algers and Werribita and her mother were gathering in the corn. Like any family in the territory, the Algers were expected to make a contribution that could be distributed to the whole. As Nash points out, the annual acknowledgement was not an act of charity, as Werribita clearly could plant her own field, but a symbolic act that embedded settlers in an indigenous redistributive system. In giving them corn, the Algers were at least symbolically acknowledging not only the women leaders, but our mother, from whom they also were drawing nourishment. The old stories warned that the newcomers would crave the corn mother's body, would try to steal it. Part of Werribita's responsibility was to encourage them instead to follow her original instructions, to divide among you the flesh and bone of the first mother, corn and tobacco, and let all shares be alike, in order to carry out the love of your first mother. Part 1. The Education of Weetamoo and James Printer. Exchange, Diplomacy, Dispossession. 1. Namampum, our beloved kinswoman, Song Squaw of Pocasset, Bonds, Acts, Deeds. Squaw Sockum, our beloved cousin, kinswoman, Nonaquaket, July 1651. A unique Indian deed is the earliest surviving awikigan, or written instrument, to which Weetamoo of Pocasset set her mark. In the document dated July 26, 1651, the great Sockum, Usamequin, his son, Wamsada, and his son by marriage, Tospaquin, recognized Weetamoo, then known as Namumpum, as both the neighboring Squaw Sockum and their kinswoman. They declared as neighbor Sockums, who bordered upon the confines and inheritance of our beloved cousin, that only Namumpum held the symbolic and legal authority to permit settlement at Pocasset, while acknowledging her right to allow an individual settler, Richard Morris, to inhabit a tract of land in her territory of Nenequaket, or Pogasic Neck. The document also mapped crucial indigenous relationships. The deed concerned a small neck of coastal wetland in Pocasset, on the east side of Tetiquet, Tonton River, the great waterway of the Wampanoag country. At the center of Pocasset was the river Kwekashand, a series of fishing falls, which flowed from Watupa, a long spring-fed pond. Namumpum maintained a town with her kin by the deep pool at the falls, but they relied on a vast ecological range, including cedar swamps to the south and forested uplands to the north. They maintained several planting fields, including one at Nanaquaket. Beside crystalline coastal waters, trails and canoe routes enabled travel from Kwekashand southward past Nanaquaket Pond to the neighboring Song Squaw Awashunk's territory of Sakonnet and coastal Akoksit, and northwards via the Tetiquet to Usamequin and Wamsada's territory of Pokanoket, Tuspaquin's town of Namasket and Kohanet, where the Pocasset Path joined the Tetiquet Trail. In the heat of July, Pocasset families would have been living on the coast and ponds, fishing, gathering, shellfish, harvesting plants from the salt and cedar marshes, and returning periodically to check the growth of their planting fields. To the west of Nanaquaket's planting grounds on the neck, their English neighbor, Richard Morris, with their permission, left his cattle to graze on the copious salt marsh grasses. the cows confined by water on both sides of the peninsula. Yet summer was not all subsistence, but a season of diplomacy. While this deed confirmed Morris's right, it also recorded a council among Salcombs, Indigenous diplomatic rhetoric intertwining with English legal discourse. The deed signals the way in which leaders like Usamequin and Namumpum had begun to adapt the tool of writing to play a role similar to wampum, the powerful shell bead which bound people together and bound words to deeds. Adhering to traditional protocols, the Salcombs opened their statements by invoking bonds of kinship, the framework on which governance rested, declaring they were of the blood and kindred of Namumpum. Algonquin languages express kinship through pronouns like my, our, and his. Yet these terms do not denote possession, but rather evoke responsibilities and shared histories that bind people to each other and the land. Every pronouncement of kinship invokes a bond, while Nigowes, my mother, evokes the birth cord that connects the infant to its mother. Ndakina, our land, evokes the cord that ties the people to our nourishing motherland. Moreover, these terms embed inclusivity and exclusivity. To Usamequin and his neighboring Salcombs, Namumpum was my kinswoman, our cousin, as well as his brother's daughter. Deceptively simple words, which, like wampum, bound their expression of reciprocal kinship to their deeds. Yet his words also drew bounds around our land, making clear that those outside the bonds of kinship, in this case, the Plymouth settlers, could claim neither Weetamoo nor her land as their own. The bonds of kinship also required Salcombs to respect the bonds and bounds between their territories, our land, on which families relied for sustenance. In the deed, Usamequin, the leader recognized as Massasoit, the great Salcom of the Wampanoag, and Plymouth's most valued ally, spoke with reverence for his kinswoman, insisting he commanded neither obedience nor authority in the territory of her inheritance. Further, Usamequin stated, I never did nor intended to put under Plymouth any of my kinswoman's land, but my own inheritance. And therefore I do disallow of any pretended claim to this land, marking a clear boundary between Plymouth's pretended assertions and Namumpum's jurisdiction. Usamequin expressed Namumpum's exclusive relationship to Pocasset, a symbolic representation of the collective right of Pocasset families, which he was obliged to respect as her kinsman and neighbor. Indeed, one crucial function of summer councils and this written instrument was to cement and clarify relationships between neighboring peoples and their territories, including settlers. In the discourse of English land tenure, the deed allowed Rhode Islander Richard Morris the right to claim this neck at Nanaquaket as property, a tract caught off from Pocasset, which he could pass down to his descendants or sell to another individual. Yet, in the context of Indigenous councils, the writing registered Namumpum's protection of the usage rights of a single settler whom she had allowed in her territory against the claims of Plymouth men. The fledgling colony of Plymouth pretended to claim preemptive rights to the entire Wampanoag country. Through their alliance with Usamequin, the legitimacy and bounds of their patent rested in part on their treaty with him. Plymouth interpreted Usamequin's role as Chief Salcom and his inheritance of a great tract of land as rule of and rights to all Wampanoag territory. Yet this deed represents a clear example of Usamequin denying that he had the power of a king, Although he may have put my land under Plymouth government, he formalized in writing that he never did nor intended to put under Plymouth any of my kinswoman's land. The use of the word under is telling. While Usamequin and Namumpum acted within an indigenous rhizomatic system of kinship, the English settlers at Plymouth sought to incorporate them into interlocking hierarchies of governance. In the first treaty between Usamequin and the settlers, shortly after their arrival at Patuxet in 1620, Edward Winslow and his fellow émigrés declared that King James would esteem of him as his friend and ally, implying equality between the Great Sachem and the king. In subsequent renewals, the Plymouth men tried to place Usamequin and his sons under the English king, who imagined all these territories as his own, setting out the boundaries on paper, lines of latitude and longitude that crossed lands from sea to sea, upon which he would never step foot. Likewise, although most of the Plymouth men had never been to Pocasset, they claimed it under their imagined jurisdiction, by right of their patent from the king and their treaty with Usamequin. That spring of 1651, they had already imagined dividing Ponkatiset, Pocasset, Neck, including the cove of Vespowit, among themselves over and against Rhode Island. But in an ironic turn, Usamequin's role as Massasoit, a great ambassador, compelled him to use his diplomatic ability to make his allies comprehend Wampanoag territorial relationships and Namumpum's authority. Namumpum maintained here and throughout her lifetime that her Pocasset motherland was her just inheritance. She had the right and responsibility to maintain its integrity, and she, in consultation with her families, would decide whom she would allow to enter her network of kin. With this deed, Massasoit recognized Namumpum's exclusive right to grant usage rights to an individual settler in a particular place in her territory. Although Rhode Islanders like Morris and the Plymouth men regarded Pocasset Neck as potential pasture, to Namumpum, the ancient cove of Vespowit and marsh of Nanaquaket sustained a vast network above and below the ground, which she was bound to preserve. This chapter will explore a number of deeds in which Weetamoo Namumpum appears as a major diplomatic figure, setting a crucial, complex stage for her alliance building during King Philip's War. The Sunksqua materializes only on the eve of the war in most histories, which too often rely on post-war narratives that displace both her diplomacy and the war waged against Indigenous women. Thus, this chapter necessarily fills a substantial gap in the record. These documents demonstrate Weetamoo's leadership prior to the war, as well as the challenge she posed to Puritan men and their colonial desires. Moreover, these documents, read in the context of Native networks of kinship and geography, reveal that Wampanoag leaders did not merely acquiesce to or resist progressive land loss and dispossession, but devised strategic adaptations to colonization, including the deeds and improvements that settlers imposed upon the land. Each section will present a document and lead the audience through interpretations, illuminated through geography and Indigenous cultural frameworks. Juxtaposing Weetamoo's struggles and strategic adaptations with some of the women and men in her extensive network, this chapter asks us to interpret rhizomatically from the time and place of particular deeds to contiguous locations and scenarios, which provide crucial context for interpretation. While Weetamoo's appearances in the historical record may first appear sparse, this chapter builds a frame through which we will be able to better understand her motivations and adaptations prior to King Philip's War. You have rather bine a husband than a wife. If Usamequin and Namampum stood on Anaquaket Neck as they exchanged words, they would have seen a small village across the narrows, which the English settlers called Pocasset, a name likely borrowed from the neighboring Wampanoag territory. The origin story of this fledgling English settlement where Morse lived elucidates the challenge Namampum posed to colonial men as a woman whose authority was recognized by the most influential native men they knew. The story also reveals early competition for jurisdiction among English colonists. Indeed, Plymouth leaders desired to claim the land of Pocasset Neck against the people of Pocasset, not only because of the land's resources, but to enforce their power versus wayward settlers who had rebelled against their neighboring colony in Massachusetts Bay and set up their own colony, which came to be known as Rhode Island. Pocasset, later renamed Portsmouth, had been established on Aquidneck Island in 1638 when Narragansett leaders, including Canonicus and his nephew Miantonomo, granted occupancy rights to a group of exiles in a series of councils brokered by Roger Williams. Their words bound with strings of wampum, the Salcombs gave the English families permission to exclusively inhabit the island, where they could plant, graze livestock, build houses, and a church. Likewise, Usamequin gave them permission to cut grass from neighboring necks and coves, and they agreed to give annual rent in the form of a coat, acknowledgement of a Salcombship, and their usage rights in Wampanoag territory. These first settlers of the island had been expelled from Massachusetts Bay in 1637 as a result of the Antinomian Controversy, a conflict associated with the notorious Anne Hutchinson, who deigned to take on the role of teacher, gathering a small congregation of women in her Boston home who posed questions about John Cotton's weekly sermon. At the root of the blasphemy was her belief, shared with the minister John Wheelwright, her sister's husband, that predestined salvation or justification could be discerned only through inner assurance of God's grace, not through reading the signs and evidence of salvation, known as sanctification, in outward behavior. This notion posed a threat to the authority of the ministers. If an individual could, through inner reflection and prayer, discern the presence of grace, she did not require confirmation by any outside body, including her minister. Hutchinson was by no means the first to propound this belief, but she was regarded as its most vexing proponent and, as a woman, the most vulnerable one. Using gendered language, Edward Johnson called her the grand mistress of all the rest, and her nemesis, Governor John Winthrop, suggested she was the mother of the antinomian controversy, the breeder and nourisher of all these distempers. Still, it was Hutchinson's appropriation of a masculine leadership role that caused the greatest offense. During her church trial, the minister, Hugh Peter, chastised, "You have stepped out of your place. You have rather bind a husband than a wife, and a preacher than a hearer, and a magistrate than a subject." As Mary Beth Norton has observed, Hutchinson was punished by the ministers for her refusal to occupy a woman's proper place. After two protracted trials, first in the general court and then in Boston's first church, the Bay Colony's leaders banished Hutchinson, along with Wheelwright and other defenders. Roger Williams, likewise exiled for controversies over religious doctrine, brokered a council with the Narragansetts to make space for the exiles in the fledgling colony of Rhode Island. Thus, the first English village settled adjacent to Weetamoo's town and named for her territory originated with a woman who stepped out of her place to assume a leadership role. Hutchinson and Weetamoo challenged the beliefs and structure of Puritan society by asserting a space of authority for women. In Weetamoo's country, banishment was reserved for the worst offenses, unthinkable acts of violence and family betrayal that threatened the whole. However, Hutchinson's world rested on a firm hierarchy of male authority. in which families, farms, towns, and colonies needed to be husbanded into order by men designed by God to govern those below them. The rebellion of a woman, or the failure of men to control and yoke their subordinates, threatened to push the entire social order toward chaos. Planting Pocasset. That July of 1651, as she returned from the council, Namumpum, Weetamoo, might have joined her kinswoman to check on their planting fields nearby Nanaquaket and Kwekwishon. By midsummer, the corn stalks likely reached toward the sun, tasseling, drawing bees to light among them. Beneath the stalks, squash vines would extend across the mounds, wide green leaves expanding to provide shade, blossoms beckoning to bees. From among the leaves, bean tendrils would spiral around the stalks, climbing toward sunflowers and sunchokes, delicate white flowers promising fruit. Working alongside the plants, the women would have coaxed soil up the mounds with non-invasive shells and hoes, ensuring the shallow corn roots were protected, not only by squash leaves, but their own hands. The Plymouth and Portsmouth settlers might have seen a terrible chaos of tangled vines, but this ecological cornucopia had its own order, a network of relationships that fostered long-term sustainability. Across the Sakonnet River, Namumpum might have noticed a stark difference in the planting fields at Portsmouth. No large mounds rose from the earth. No women cultivated communal fields. Even Anne Hutchinson, allowed comparable freedom at Aquidneck, would have been confined in her work to the domestic household and kitchen garden, tending orderly rows of lettuce, turnips, and herbs. One of the first acts of the Englishmen at Pocasset was to divide the land into household lots, each owned and governed by a husband. They divided lots into parcels, designated for a house, pasturage for cattle, outbuildings to house livestock and fodder in winter, and a fence planting field. If, as a child, Namumpum had observed the Hutchinson household across the narrows of the river, she might have seen William standing on the neck of the cove in his field, accompanied by two massive horned creatures yoked to a plow. In the soil, he would have commanded the oxen to make parallel furrows in long, deep, uniform lines. When this arduous task was completed, William would have taken his oxen to the other side of the rectangular field and compelled them to repeat the parallel rows to cross the previous ones. If William planted in the manner typical of Plymouth colonists, he would sow the English grains of wheat, barley, and rye in the rows and plant corn in small hills at the intersections, or, alternatively, he might have planted English and Indian crops in separate fields. Just as the English king placed an imagined grid over the continent, and settlers placed imagined grids over native territories to make towns, thus a man husbanded the land into an imagined order, creating a grid to contain native corn and English grain within his properly bounded fields. The Englishmen in Portsmouth and Plymouth, the Sunk Squaw, may have already known, gazed longingly across the narrows at her meadows and fields. They desired her planting grounds, cultivated and fallow, her marshlands, salt and fresh, with the passion of the righteous, believing that the land's destiny was to be converted with the plow, yoked like oxen, husbanded to its proper purpose, and transformed to field and pasture. Namumpum, Squawsalkum of Pocasset. While Portsmouth men solidified their identity as planters by husbanding the land into orderly fields, Pocasset women derived strength from cultivating the intertwined mounds. Weetamoo's leadership arose from her role as a cultivator of diplomacy. The 1651 Nanaquaket deed recognized Namumpum's title as Squawsalkum, a phrase Englishmen erroneously translated as queen or Salcombe's wife. English women's status was defined primarily by the men to whom they were bound, by birth to their father's rank, and by marriage to their husbands. Thus, it was challenging, despite the recent reign of Queen Elizabeth I, for English settlers to conceive of a native woman governing in her own right, particularly given that, in their hierarchies of race, class, and gender, an Indian woman would rank far below themselves. Nevertheless, in Algonquin communities and languages, the title Sunk Squaw was commonly applied to women leaders like Werribita and Weetamoo as equals to their male relations. They were the rock women on whom entire communities relied. These titles contain the most important role that Sogmok and Sogsquok played. They were not ruling kings and queens, but rather ambassadors, hard-bodied diplomats who traveled to other nations, carried their communities' deliberative decisions, communicated effectively and persuasively with other leaders, and traveled swiftly to return the wider deliberations home. Rather than singular authorities, they formed part of a leadership network, which also included counselors and elders. Their collective responsibilities are embedded in the rhetoric of the Nanaquacket deed. The Pocasset families entrusted Namumpum to represent their intertwined interest and their collective sovereignty and their territory. She had inherited this role from her father, Konbitant, as well as her mother, but had risen to this capacity through her community's trust. In council, she received acknowledgement from neighboring Salcombes, including Usamequin's commitment to uphold the Sunk Squaw's right at Pocasset against the claims of Plymouth. Likewise, she ensured that the right they had allowed to their Portsmouth neighbor would be respected. She ensured the bonds with their Wampanoag kin and the more delicate strands that connected them to their new neighbors would be cultivated and upheld. This woman, Tatapanam, Patuxet, 1659. Sometime after Usamequin made his declaration regarding Weetamoo's authority in 1651, Weetamoo married Wamsada, his eldest son, in a dual marriage alliance, joining her sister, Wutanakanusk, with Metacom, further cementing the bonds between these Wampanoag leadership families, ensuring peace, security, and exchange between them. It appears, however, that soon after this marriage, the Plymouth men sought to use this bond to access Weetamoo's lands. According to the Plymouth Book of Deeds, on Christmas Eve, 1657, Plymouth leaders James Cutworth, Josiah Winslow, Constance Southworth, William Bradford's stepson, and the tavern keeper John Barnes cornered Wamsada regarding a debt to Barnes that had come due that very day. They compelled him to sign a bond for a parcel of land which they say is granted by the court of Plymouth unto themselves with some others. Yet, according to their testimony, Wamsada insisted he was not willing at present to sell all they do desire. Much of the court's grant was on Pocasset land, which Wamsada had neither the right nor the authority to concede. The Book of Deeds recorded that over a year later, in April 1659, Tatapanam, Nanumpum, Weetamoo, released her husband from the bond by her signed consent to convey those lands to a group of 26 freemen, including those who compelled the bond. The large tract included all the upland and meadow on the easterly side of the Tonton River, from Kwekwechand to the narrowing of a sonnet neck, as well as the meadow on the westerly side of Tonton River to the head of the Wapasset River. The document reported that Wamsada and Weetamoo had relinquished for themselves and their heirs any right and title unto any part and parcel thereof. Then, in June 1659, the Book of Deeds recorded, Wamsutta and this woman, Tatapanam, appeared before Josiah Winslow and William Bradford Jr., acknowledging that the previous agreement was their free act and deed. These documents demonstrate a stark contrast with the Nanaquaket deed, which recognized Namumpum as Song Squaw and conveyed to a single settler the right to use a small tract of land. The freeman's deed encompassed much of northern Pocasset and authorized a large group of settlers to divide the land into lots which could be sold for profit and developed into farms, mills, and pasture. The deed registered a different set of relationships as well. While acknowledging Wampanoag authority to convey land, the instrument invested the Plymouth men and the English king with jurisdiction over them, asserting that Usamequin, Wamsutta, and Tatapanam were natives inhabiting and living within the government of New Plymouth in New England in America. With such deeds, the Plymouth men further constructed their vision of New England as colonial space, in which natives were inhabitants rather than sovereigns. Although only Wamsutta and Namumpum's marks were affixed to the deed, the document also implied that these leaders consented to this construct and to their status in the colonial hierarchy. Moreover, while no titles or kinship ties appeared, Namumpum's gender was marked in English terms. Some historians looking back upon the few words that the Plymouth men recorded might regard these documents simply as land transactions, but the records reflect merely the surface of the waters below, often concealing oral and symbolic exchanges and the acts that followed. Even the record itself reveals a compelling anomaly. All of these statements, from December 1657 to June 1659, were recorded in the same place in the Plymouth Book of Deeds, at the same time. Written on two sides of the same page, they immediately precede the division of the lands in question in 1666. Their veracity relies on the testimony of Plymouth men to the consenting acts of Wamsutta and this woman, Tatapanam. Although the historical record is sparse and sometimes confounding, composed largely of the brief phrases recorded as acts of the court, we can use a network of documents to read the scenarios that took place at both Pocasset and Plymouth, and drawing on Indigenous language, geography, and other cultural frameworks, we can begin to interpret what might have taken place on the ground. The Road to Patuxet. Ironically, the men who claimed jurisdiction over the whole Wampanoag country had only recent and limited familiarity with its geography. Winslow and Southworth were foreigners who claimed the rights of firstborn sons. In contrast, when Weetamoo went to Plymouth, she traveled through territory she knew intimately. For her, this was not New England, but Wampanoag, ancestral ground. As she walked the familiar path from Pocasset with her counselors, Weetamoo would have followed the Connecticut north, passing through the ancient planting grounds at a sonnet, grown high with grasses and edible plants. New plants intermingled among native ones, dandelion, red clover, Englishman's foot, first brought to these lands in cattle dung. Wamsutta could have joined her en route from Poconoket at the junction with the Connecticut Trail, near Kohanet, a key fishing place. Some 20 years before, the settlement of Tonton had emerged here when a high-ranking spinster, Elizabeth Poole, who had left the Massachusetts Bay Colony, made an agreement with local native leaders to live nearby Kohanet, on a stream off the main trail. Here, when Weetamoo was still a child, Poole had tended her cattle, relying for support on her brother and a small group of settlers who followed after her. Weetamoo may have passed by Poole's old house or seen her cows grazing as she walked by the stream. From Kohanet, the Connecticut Trail led east, a road long traveled by diplomats. A canopy of nut trees provided shade from the sun's rays. At Nemasket, Weetamoo, Wamsutta and their company could stop to refresh and exchange news with Tuspaquin, Amy, and their kin. From there, the Nemasket Trail led them to the coast and the old town of Patuxet, where the English settlement of Plymouth had arisen from ground depleted by disease. As she approached it, Weetamoo must have encountered cows roaming without constraint during warm months, and men from the outlying settlements drawing cattle or carrying meat and cheese to market. As Weetamoo entered the English village, she must have been struck by its structure, square houses built on long, narrow lots lining the sides of the road.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.